All right, hi, Bills are science students, and anyone else who might be watching.
Hi.
Today we have an awesome guest speaker. Her name is Dr. Melinda Earnest, and she is someone I've known for a while. She specializes in physical therapy, that's her job, and she works with all sorts of different types of people, and especially knows a lot about Paralympics. She knows a lot about designing wheelchairs for all types of bodies to be able to participate in sports. And so she's going to talk to you guys about what she does for a living. And she's also going to talk to you about how that relates to mass and force and velocity, which is what we are studying in physics right now. If you have a question or comment for her, type in your live stream chats, comments, and I'll do my best to relay those to her throughout this presentation. Okay? Thank you for coming today, Dr. Earnest. Take it away.
All right. Hi, everyone. Like Ms. Cleaver said, my name is Dr. Mimi Earnest.
All right. Hi, everyone. Like Ms. Cleaver said, my name is Dr. Mimi Earnest, or Melinda Earnest, but you guys can call me Mimi.
I just turned off my camera.
I'm
trying to share my
Cleaver, would you look? I'm trying to share my screen, and I am not able
to. Like Ms. Cleaver said, I am here to talk to you guys.
No worries. Like Ms. Cleaver said, I am here to talk to you guys about wheelchairs. There we go. Get our screen up now. Excellent. Okay. So. I'm going to talk to you guys about forces and how those relate to wheelchairs, especially in adaptive sports.
Like Ms. Cleaver said, I'm a physical therapist. I work at the University.
A little bit about me. Like Ms. Cleaver said, I'm a physical therapist. I work at the University of Cincinnati in Ohio. I also work with a sports club called the Greater Cincinnati Adaptive Sports Club, and I work with Team USA Wheelchair Rugby. And here's a couple pictures of Ms. Cleaver and I from high school when we were growing up together. So when you guys think about a wheelchair, there might be a few different things that you think about. Maybe you think about a chair like this, which is what we call a standard stock wheelchair. Maybe you think of this, which is an electric scooter. Maybe you think about this, which is an electric wheelchair or a power chair.
And just use their hands.
Which someone wouldn't use their arms to push, they would use a little toggle device and just use their hands or even their head or their eyes to move the chair. Or maybe since you guys read the article in Science about wheelchair sports, you think about this, which is a wheelchair rugby chair. But the most important thing when you think about a wheelchair is that there's actually a person in it. So when you see someone using a wheelchair, make sure you look at the person and not just stare at their wheelchair. They're like you and me. They have things that they like, things that they don't like. They have activities they enjoy doing. And just like for you and I, it's important for people who use wheelchairs to exercise and move, because that's what's going to help them stay healthy. Is it hard to run in a pair of shoes that's really big? So what usually happens when you run in a pair of shoes that's really big?
You might slip and slide your foot in the shoe. Your shoes might even fall off.
Your shoes might even fall off, and you might get blisters, and your feet will probably hurt. The same happens for people who use wheelchairs if their wheelchair doesn't fit right. So they'll move around in the chair, and if they're in their wheelchair and maybe a force from another wheelchair hits them, or if they're going down a hill, they might even fall out of the wheelchair. And their legs and their hips might get bruises and blisters, and they're probably going to be in some pain. So when we think about wheelchairs, and especially for me as a physical therapist, I think and I know that the wheelchair is an extension of the person who's using it. We want it to move with their body well. And in for order it to do that, it needs to fit.
This is called a day chair.
And so when we're thinking about wheelchairs here on the screen, this is called a day chair. So someone who uses a wheelchair, most of the time, they'll have a chair like this. And then I'm going to really quick, let's get you guys so you can.
So I have a wheelchair here with us.
Look at me.
And this is a wheelchair.
There we go. So I have a wheelchair here with us. And this is a wheelchair basketball.
chair. And on the screen, I talked about a backrest. So this is the backrest. When someone's sitting in the chair, this comes up to their back. And then we have the wheels here, which usually they can come on and off, which is important because this wheelchair has something called camber, which we'll talk about later, which makes the chair really wide and it won't let it fit through most of the door frames. So you need to be able to take these off. Removing wheelchair or wheels is also important if someone who's using a chair is getting in and out of their car to drive, right? They need to be able to get into the car and then lift the chair up and into the back seat or the seat next to them, which is also important when we're thinking about the mass of a chair and how much force they're going to have to exert to pick the chair up. Now in the chair too, we have a cushion, right? Just to keep people comfortable, they can help add support. Then we have the seat, which is under the cushion and the person will sit on. And then, for people who have legs and feet that need wheelchairs, they're going to have a foot plate, which is right here. And then this big metal part of the chair, and when we think about what a chair is made of or what type of metal, this part here is called the frame of the chair. It's like the skeleton of the chair that helps keep everything together. The width of the chair, right, is going to be similar to the width of the person's hips. So we measure it from here to here. And that's important to have it a nice snug fit to make sure that the person stays in their chair and doesn't fall out. And something else you'll notice in this chair is that it has these little wheels in the front. These are called front caster wheels, okay? And the bigger wheels here, sometimes we call them rear wheels. And then in the back, there's an anti-tip wheel or another caster wheel. And that's important because if this wheel wasn't here, if this chair got hit hard enough, or they went up and maybe someone's doing a wheelie and they don't have an anti-tipper on their day chair, the chair will topple over backwards. So this back caster wheel helps give lots of support. Another measurement in a chair is the depth of the chair. So the depth is the measurement from someone's hip down to their knee. So that would be from here to here. And one other thing that we'll talk about too is the wheelchair dump or the slope of the seat. So if you look at this chair, there's quite a little, this angle here is quite little. And that's gonna help someone who's maybe their core muscles don't work as well. That's gonna give them extra support. And you'll notice too that this chair is designed for someone who needs a lot of core support because this backrest is so much higher than it is in this basketball chair. Right? You can kind of see the differences in the height.
Sharing my screen with you guys.
So I'm going to go back to sharing my screen with you guys.
Okay. So again, here's just a slide explaining the different parts of the chair.
Okay. So again, here's just a slide explaining the different parts of the chair.
Okay. And this slide's talking more about the dump or the slope.
Okay. And this slide's talking more about the dump or the slope. Or the seat dump or the slope of the chair. And if you guys want to kind of experience what that's like, you can be sitting down in your chair and then maybe put a footrest under you. And you'll notice that your knees are going to be higher than your hips. And that's how you can tell if someone needs a lot of trunk stability, because when we do that, it gives us a lot of stability and support. Now, why might someone need that stability and support when they're in their wheelchair? And why might they have a bigger backrest or more seat dump in their sports chair versus their day chair, especially if they're playing a sport like rugby or basketball? It's because they're probably going to take some forces that are different than the forces that they're going to experience during every day. Then those forces are going to mean that they need more support than they usually do. So that's why they might have a higher backrest or a bigger seat dump or seat slope. And this slide here is just talking a little bit more about the backrest height and the seat depth and the width. Now, this one's talking about the camber of the wheelchair.
So
remember, that's how angled those wheels are.
Kids, you're now connected to everybody.
Yes.
You don't need to go over everything again. Just give them a rundown of the last ideas you have in like a minute or so, and you can pick up where you're at so we can hear about the sports coming up too.
Okay, awesome.
Thank you.
No, thank you, Ms. Kleber.
Okay. Okay, awesome.
So quickly, we'll review the
Yeah, no, thank you, Ms. Kleber. Okay, so quickly we'll review the parts of the chair. Again, so if someone, this is a basketball chair. I'm gonna move this down just a touch here. And in the basketball chair, someone who, why do you think that someone's backrest might be a little bit higher than another person's backrest? And we were talking about that it's likely because that person needs more trunk support because their core muscles don't work quite as well as someone else's does. So that's the reason that we have different backrest types. We might have different seat dunks again, right? Or seat slopes, because when we have our knees up higher than our hips, that puts us in another position where we have more stability, which is important when we're playing sports because we're going to be going really fast. Someone might get hit by another chair, and we want to have good stability and good support when we turn and pivot. We don't want to be in a chair that's not going to allow us to do that and might cause us to either fall out of the chair.
It sets someone's arms up in a better position.
So again, the camber helps us be able to pivot a little bit better. It sets someone's arms up in a better position to be able to push. So the position that their arms are in when there's camber is more optimal to allow them to produce more force that's going to be able to help them to push more quickly.
Now we're going to talk about wheelchair sports a little bit and the differences in some
All right.
of the chairs.
Now we're going to talk about wheelchair sports a little bit and the differences in some of the chairs. So if we're looking at the screen here, you can see that these two chairs are different, just like the athletes who are using the chairs, their bodies are different. So the player for Japan on the right, you can tell that he's sitting up a little bit taller in his chair. So he does not have quite as much seat dump, or he's not going to have as big as a, or as tall as a backrest as the athlete that he plays for Canada in the black has. You can also see that they both have the camber in their wheelchair. And then if you notice, these chairs are different. So the player for Japan, he's got more function in his core and in his arms than the player for Canada. So he's what we're going to call an offensive player. And if you look at the front of his chair, he's got a steel bumper right here. And if you look at the front of the Canadian player's chair, he's got like almost like a little metal basket, and that's what we call a picker. So someone who's a lower level player, they're going to move more slowly because their muscles can't produce enough as much force to help them move as quickly. And when we're, if you remember from your article from science class, wheelchair rugby chairs, they weigh quite a bit, right? They have one of the highest masses of any of the other sports chairs. So they're about 40 pounds, and they need to be heavy so that they can withstand the forces of other chairs hitting them. So now we'll go and we'll watch a little bit of some wheelchair rugby. This here is from the 2016 Paralympic Games in Rio. So even just looking at the screen, you can see that the athletes, they all look different from each other. This guy here, his name's Riley. He sits up tall in his chair. So his core muscles work pretty well, but he, you know, he's missing some fingers and some of his legs. And you can see we might get a good hit there. So these chairs have to be pretty, they have to have some mass so that they can withstand the force. But something else that we also think about with wheelchair rugby and designing chairs is making sure that an athlete who maybe is weaker and can't produce as much force, we want to make sure that they're still going to be able to propel their chair.
Okay. So wheelchair basketball is the next sport that we're going to talk about. And at the top, you can see.
So wheelchair basketball is the next sport that we're going to talk about. And at the top, you can see some information about the chairs and what they're made of. So the mass of a wheelchair basketball chair is less than the mass of a rugby chair. And that's because these athletes, yes, they hit, they run into each other, but they don't do it as intentionally or nearly as hard as in wheelchair basketball, or excuse me, as in wheelchair rugby. So these chairs, why do you think that they need to be a little bit lighter?
They need the combination of speed
So they're a little bit lighter because they need the combination of speed and force. In wheelchair basketball, the athletes are usually a little bit stronger. So they're going to be trying to push really, really fast. And they're going to need to have the ability to turn and to pivot while they're doing that, which would be a lot harder if the chair weighed, you know, 40 pounds or 18 kilograms like the wheelchair rugby chair does.
So on the screen,
just like in rugby, athletes come in all different sizes. So on the screen now are actually my two friends. The guy shooting the ball, his name's Ian Lynch. And then on the right, that's his name is Jacob Counts. And we coached together in Cincinnati, and they both played for Team USA. So my friend Ian, the chair that he's in is actually the one that I have in my house and was showing you guys. So Ian has a spinal cord injury. And when we have a spinal cord injury, the message that our brain sends through our spinal cord to our nerves, which then tell our muscles to move and to exert force, that signal is either blocked or it can't get through as well because, you know, there's been some type of injury to the spinal cord, sometimes through car accidents or some other type of accidents. So Ian doesn't have as good as trunk support, so he can maybe have trunk support up to about here, but if you look, he's got that big backrest. And then Jake, now he's what we call, he's an amputee, or he has limb loss and amputations. So his core muscles work just fine. His backrest is going to be a lot shorter. And then if you look down here at his by his feet, he doesn't have a foot plate because he doesn't have feet. However, he's still going to need something to help stabilize him. And that's why he has these different straps to help keep him in. So he's going to sit up a lot taller in his chair. And if you think about some of the other components that we were talking about, what other things might be different in his chair compared to Ian's? So he's not going to have as much seat dump or seat slope as Ian does because Jake doesn't need that support. And like we said, his backrest is going to be shorter. Now we'll watch a little bit of wheelchair basketball.
In his chair, in his effort.
That's okay.
Sorry, guys. I went to the wrong thing. There we go.
Sagar.
Brief pause. Sorry about the ad.
Okay. So the Team USA is in white.
All right. So now if we're watching the game, so the Team USA is in white, and this game's from the 2016 Paralympics in Rio. And right here, number 13, that's my friend Ian. So he's setting picks. And he's still pretty fast. And you can see, again, the different sizes and the different wheelchair setups for these athletes based on what their needs are and how much function and trunk control that they have. And if you see them, they're moving pretty fast. They're spinning, they're turning, they're pivoting. So they, again, they need a chair that's going to allow them to be able to go quickly, but still withstand some force when they get picks set on them and when other chairs bump into them. Okay, and the last type of wheelchair for sports that we're going to talk about is wheelchair racing. So wheelchair racing can either be done on the pavement or on the road. Like a lot of wheelchair racers compete in marathons and they'll use a racing chair. And other times it's done on a track. So maybe now or maybe next year you'll have some friends who are on the track teams that use a wheelchair when they compete, and they might have a chair that looks like this. There's a couple differences in the chairs that are on the screen right now. So the on the left, this chair is made for someone whose feet are going to go on this foot plate here towards the bottom. So they sit in a position called feet forward. And then when we look at these two other chairs, they don't have foot plates. So in the chair in the top, someone's actually going to sit on a seat. Sorry, guys. They're going to sit on a seat that's right here. I'm hovering over it. And then their knees are actually going to go under them, like they're kneeling, and they're going to rest here. And that's called a U-cage chair. Now, on the chair below it, which we called a V-cage chair, the athlete can either sit in that kneeling position, or there's a foot plate here for them to rest their feet on. Okay. And here we have a little bit about what the chair is made of and how much they weigh. So if you look at the mass of the chair, these ones are a lot lighter than the rugby chairs and than the basketball chairs because, you know, in racing, we want to go fast, fast, fast. We want to be able to be in a position where we're stopped at the starting line, and then we can get some acceleration and produce a, and get some velocity so we can go quickly as we're racing because you want to win, right? So if we look at the chairs here, what's something that you notice about the wheels that's different than maybe a rugby chair or a basketball chair? The wheels are, they're much thinner. They don't have as big as a width as the other wheels do. You might say, oh, they're a lot see-through, or what we call the spokes. They don't have as many lines in them. And then if you look here, oh, my apologies, at this circle right there, that's the push rim. And the push rim on a racing chair is much smaller, and it's coated in rubber. And then the racers are going to wear gloves. So this Tatiana McFadden, that's this athlete here. She's a 20. She has 27 Paralympic medals, and she's won 23 marathons. She's an incredible athlete. But her gloves are right here, and they're coated in rubber, so that when she goes to push on her rims, there's going to be some friction, but just a little bit, that causes her hand not to slip off. So that way, when she's pushing, she can still produce a lot of force from her muscles to make that chair move. And now we're going to watch her win a gold medal. Okay, so this is a 400 meter race. And this one's also from the 2016 Paralympic Games in Rio. And once we get to the straightaway, we'll show Tatiana. So I think that, there we go. She's towards the front of the pack now. But if you see, they're leaning forward a lot, which helps put their arms in a good position so that their muscles can produce a lot of force as they push. And they're also going pretty fast. I definitely cannot run nearly as fast as they are pushing right now. All right, and here they're coming around the last turn. And she's gonna do it. And there's one of her 27 gold medals. So you can see that because of how fast they're going, they need a chair that doesn't have as great of a mass so that they can move really, really fast. Okay. And one of the final things I wanted to share with you guys before maybe we answer some questions or I can show you how I move a little bit in the wheelchair, I wanted to give you some things where you can learn more. So this website up here at the top is going to list all of the adaptive sports and all the wheelchair sports that are in the Paralympic Games. And then if you're thinking, well, what do maybe people who have disabilities in Indianapolis, where do they go and play? A lot of the sports in Indy are by the Rehab Hospital of Indiana. So I put a link there so that you can check out some of the competitive team sports they have, and then some of the recreation programs like, canoeing and kayaking and hiking that they also offer. And then there is a movie called Rising Phoenix that's on Netflix that talks about the Paralympic movement. And then it goes through the story of a wheelchair rugby player, Riley Batt, who we saw when we were watching the rugby game. He's from Australia. And then it talks about wheelchair fencing, racing for people who have limb loss and use prosthetics, as well as long jump, which is another field sport. So, stop the share here. All right. Ms. Kleber, have there been any questions that we maybe haven't answered?
One is it dangerous for the players that are playing wheelchair basketball and wheelchair rugby?
So it's, just like in any sport, you can get injured, right? I can get injured going and playing soccer or basketball or rugby. Athletes get injured too. And I know sometimes for people who maybe aren't familiar with people who have disabilities, you can think that their body is very maybe fragile and not as strong as ours, or that it doesn't have the ability to withstand as much force. And that's typically not the case. So sure, their chairs might get knocked over, but they're athletes. So they're okay with that. And there's ways that people can get up, especially in basketball. People are strong enough to get their whole wheelchair and body up by themselves. And some people, like in rugby, they need a little bit of help. So like any sport that someone like me might play, it's dangerous, but they're going to be all right.
All right. Another one I'm seeing is, where did you go to school and what exactly does a physical therapist do?
Yeah. So I, after I graduated from high school, I went to a 4-year university and got what's called a bachelor's degree. It's called Wheeling Jesuit University, and I studied athletic training. So your school might have an athletic trainer, or in high school, there's athletic trainers, and they help athletes while they're kind of on the sideline playing the game. And then there's a lot of other things that athletic trainers can do too, but that's kind of the most common. And after I graduated with my degree in athletic training, I went to the University of Cincinnati, and I spent 3 years studying to get my Doctor of Physical Therapy degree. And as a physical therapist, there's so much you can do. I work in research, and I work with people who have had strokes. So I help them relearn how to walk, and then trying to figure out what's the best thing that I can do as a physical therapist to help them walk better. Physical therapist works with sports teams. They might work, maybe you know someone who's gone to physical therapy who maybe had a joint replacement. So physical therapists work with individuals who've had joint replacements as well. They can work with people who've had spinal cord injuries. They can work in acute care hospitals. So if someone's sick and they go and they have to stay in the hospital, physical therapists are there as well to make sure people can move safely and get back home. And there's just lots of different settings that PTs can work in. That's what makes it so fun.
Awesome. Awesome. Can you speak a little bit more about your experience with the Paralympics and other kinds of sports you've been involved with and how you got connected to these people?
Mm-hmm. So when I was in physical therapy school, I reached out to the local Cincinnati Recreation Commission. And I asked if I could come and help with their wheelchair basketball team, which is the Cincinnati Dragons, who I work with now. We have a middle school and elementary school team, and then we have a high school team, and then we have a wheelchair basketball team for adults. Some of them are in college, and some of them are, you know, maybe 40 or 50 years old, and they like to play basketball for exercise. And what I do with the Paralympics is a couple summers ago, I went down to Alabama and I watched a tournament that Team USA Wheelchair Rugby was in. And I met with their athletic trainer and to learn from him more about wheelchair sports and adaptive sports. And then I kind of connected with him and I ended up being asked to go down to Alabama the next time that the team is there to help be their athletic trainer and their physical therapist with the other athletic trainer that I met. So we do things like, you know, if their shoulder hurts, we might give them some tissue mobilization or some exercises to help keep their muscles nice and strong. Or, you know, if they fall and hit their head and they get a concussion, we'll work with them to make sure that they're safe and help take care of any of the symptoms or the maybe some pain or dizziness that they might be having with that. Or if they just like get a cut or a bruise, we'll help take care of that as well. A lot of it too is making sure that they're healthy and hydrated and that they're eating well. So we will give them lots of water or maybe some Gatorade too.
Okay, I'm getting a few questions about the classes of players. Can you like describe what exactly is the role of the spinal cord in these injuries? Why does that, you know, how does that affect the body in different ways? And can you talk to us just a little bit about the different classes within these sports?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so when our bodies move, our muscles are producing a force, right? So my bicep muscle is producing a force on my bones here to cause it to come up. And it's able to produce that force because there was a signal from my brain through my spinal cord to the, they're called nerves, and it's the nerves that ultimately send the signal to our muscles telling it to produce that force. So when someone has a spinal cord injury, either the signal, the injury is so severe that no signal from the brain can get down to the to get to the nerves, to get to the muscles, to get it to move, or that signal, it's got to take a different path, and there's something kind of blocking it a little bit so that the signal's not as strong. So in when we're thinking about classifications and we're talking about someone who's an athlete that has a spinal cord injury, different levels of our spinal cord send signals to different muscles. So typically, if I get an injury that's around here on my spinal cord, I might have some decreased signal sent to my trunk muscles, so my trunk's not gonna be as strong, and then my legs will also be affected. The higher the injury is in the spinal cord, or the closer it is going up towards the brain, we're gonna have more trunk muscles or core muscles that are involved. And sometimes too, if it's high enough, which is typically what we see in wheelchair rugby if they have a spinal cord injury, their shoulders and their arms and their hand muscles are gonna be affected. So that they're either not gonna get a signal at all or the signal is gonna be weak. The more weakness that there is in a person or in an athlete, they are going to be given a class that's lower. So in adaptive sports, especially in team sports, classifications are important to make sure that the playing field is level, right? So if we go back and we think about basketball, my friend Jake, so his trunk muscles all work, his arms are nice and strong, he's just missing parts of his leg. So imagine if he was missing just his foot, right? So he's got a lot of good stability from his legs, from the one leg that's on his foot plate. And if we had him out there sitting up nice and tall, able to reach up towards the basket, playing against my friend Ian, who doesn't have as good as trunk stability. And if he's in his chair and he gets hit really hard, he's going to go forward because he's not able, he doesn't have the trunk support or the core support to keep him up. So the classification exists so that we don't have five Jakes out there playing basketball against five Ians, because the difference in the winner of the game isn't going to be related to the skill of the player. It's probably going to be related to, because Jake's team's going to physically be able to function and do more than Ian's. So the lower the classification, which is usually a point system. So Ian is a class 1.0 in basketball. That's as low as there is. And then it goes up by half increments. So 1, 1.5, 2, 2.5, all the way up to 4.5. And in basketball, all the athletes are out on the court with their classifications or their numbers. And all of their numbers can't add up past 14. And it's a little bit different than it is for rugby. In rugby, you can only have 8 points out on the court. But again, classifications are based on the physical function of the athlete, not the skill of the athlete. And they help make sure that the game and the winner of the game is based on
skill. Awesome. Great answer. Thank you. I'm getting a lot of people asking about what inspired you to be a physical therapist and what you really enjoy about your job.
So I first went to physical therapy when I was in sixth grade. I had some knee pain, and my physical therapist, his name was Mark. I was playing soccer, and he liked to play soccer and watch soccer. So I loved going to physical therapy and talking to him. And I liked too that he could be up and moving all day. He wasn't necessarily sitting down all day. And as someone who was pretty active, that was really cool to me. And I thought I wanted to work with athletes. And I thought maybe I would go and work with, you know, professional soccer players. And then when I got to college, I worked with the Special Olympics. So I worked with people who either have intellectual disabilities, and they were some pretty stellar athletes. And I got to thinking, I wonder what they get to do for fun. Like, if they're not at practice for the Special Olympics, what else do they do and how does their body work? So that's how I got interested in neuro rehab, or in learning more about the spinal cord and the brain and the nervous system, as well as in adaptive sports. And I love my job because I get to talk to people and have relationships with people, and I get to learn a lot of things. I'm someone who really likes to learn, and I think that the human body is so cool. Like when I think about how the signal goes from the brain down the spinal cord to the nerves to innervate our muscles, I just think it is fascinating. And that kind of everything that we do, and even talking, like my brain is working really hard right now to send signals to the muscles that innervate my mouth. And my vocal cords are working. So I just think it's really cool. And, you know, if you think that's cool, physical therapy could be a cool profession for you, or maybe a related profession like recreation therapists. They work a lot with adaptive sports, and they get to do a lot of fun stuff. Or there's occupational therapists who help people make sure that they can that they can get dressed and things like that. Or being a doctor, or maybe an engineer and designing wheelchairs. But if you guys are learning about something and you think it's pretty interesting, there's definitely a career out there that relates to that, that you guys can hopefully awesome. Find and
just
learn more about.
One more question. This one is kind of long, but what they're getting at is, what is the difference between what the person that designed each part of the wheelchair does versus what is the physical therapist's role in designing these wheelchairs that are specialized for different types of sports?
Mm-hmm.
So wheelchairs, they're ultimately designed by an engineer. So an engineer is going to figure out the different angles. So when we think about the seat dump, they're going to build a chair and make sure that the metal that they use is going to be able to keep the chair in that position. And they're also thinking about things that I will think about. So they'll think about, the caster wheels and how big do they need to be. And when I meet someone who, we'll say someone who just acquired, they just got a spinal cord injury, and they're going to need a wheelchair to help them get throughout the day. So I'm going to look at that person and I'm going to say, okay, how strong is their core and their trunk? And I'm going to say, okay, I'm looking at all these different wheelchairs that these engineers have designed. Which one do I think is going to be best for the person that I'm working with? I don't work directly with the engineers, but I work with what we call assistive technology professionals. And those are people who really, really specialize, and they know all there is to know about wheelchairs. And they often work with engineers and the companies that the engineers work with to make sure that they're always thinking about things. And if there is a design or a wheelchair out there and they can't find one that's the best fit for a person who needs it, then those ATPs, or those assistive technology professionals, are going to go work with the engineers to design a chair to make sure there's something out there for someone who needs it. So I'll take some measurements for a wheelchair, and I'll measure the person's, the width of their hips or the length of their femurs, or maybe the height of the backrest that they need. And then I'm going to take all those measurements, and I'm going to work with the ATP. And then from there, we're going to give them to the engineers who work at the companies that design the chairs, and they're going to be the ones who build the chairs. And then they'll send it all back, and then that's how the person is going to get their wheelchair.
Okay, I'll end with a fun one, and then I'm going to tell our Belzer students something you can do extra if you're interested in this topic. One last question. Who are some of your role models or inspirations, in whether they're in your field or not?
So there's a couple. I have a lot of the professors that I learned from in college, who I would say are my role models. The people who taught me, who are very passionate about what they do. So Shalee Englehart is one of them. Another person that I admire is someone that I work with who does research. His name is Pierce Boyne. And then there's a lot of like other neurophysical therapists that I that have been working as physical therapists a lot longer than I have, who just have so much knowledge that they do. And then a lot of my role models are the athletes that I get to work with, because I can learn so much from them. That's going to help me be a better physical therapist. And then I can go and use what I've learned from them and how they maybe get around and do things in their daily life. And then I can teach my patients who are new to having a disability.
Well, thank some you of those so, tips so and much, tricks Dr. from Ernest. Them. What I'll say lastly to our students is we're all virtually thanking you right now. And you guys have an opportunity for an extra credit assignment that's in Canvas that goes along with the presentation you've been working on today. You can follow the instructions on slide 4 of that assignment and come up with some kind of purpose that you would like to design a wheelchair for. We've included some resources that have a lot of different parts that you can add to the wheelchair or different kinds of settings you would choose. And you'll tell us, what is this wheelchair designed for? Why did you make it the mass you did? So did you make it heavy or lightweight and why? And then we want you to include a model so we can see what it would look like with labels to understand the different parts you included. When you're done, you can send it to your teacher and we will share it with Dr. Earnest and she can give feedback on your design. Because in science, we do iterative designs, which means that we don't ever just stop at one design and say, we got it, we're done. You have to constantly be improving to make the lives of the people you're designing these products for as best as possible. So please do that. Check it out, especially here at the end of the semester. And thanks again, Dr. Earnest. We really appreciate your time. That was great.
Thank you so much.
All right. Bye, everybody.
Thank you guys so much.